Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Father, I kneel before you and humbly ask, God, you would come into this place tonight. Welcome, Holy Spirit. You are the teacher of the church, not a man or a woman, not the young or the old, not the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. God, this is not about us coming to hear from the wisdom, the ideas, the philosophies of man. God, we don't want just a preacher's commentary, Lord. We want the Holy Spirit's wisdom and direction. Reveal your word to us. Holy Spirit, be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, the correction that we need for our lives. Holy Spirit, part of your job description is to show us things to come. And so I ask, God, that as we look at future events, that you would show us what is to take place, God. Most of all, that we would get a vision of Jesus Christ, greater, more awesome and powerful in our mind's eye, God, that we would see him with the eye of faith, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, running with endurance the race that is set out before us. Lord, we thank you for that. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire, as well as around the planet, that are preaching and hearing the gospel. There are brothers and sisters, Lord, we love them. We don't think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-workers and laborers together in your field, building your kingdom. God, also, we don't forget the persecuted church scattered abroad throughout the world. We bless them. Pray your protection, your provision, God, your healing, your encouragement, and your strength. God, deliver them, Lord, out of the hand of their enemies, God, out of prisons and bondages, Lord. And we thank you, Father God, that they will endure to the end. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say,
amen.
Amen. Tonight, once you get your Bibles out, go with me to the book of 1 John. Little John, okay, one John, some call it. First John. Tonight we're talking about the end times. This is the end times part number 4. We're talking about the Antichrist tonight, okay? As we look at the end times and as we see specific events that have to take place in order for this whole thing to be wrapped up, we realize and recognize that there are some things that are going to take place. Let me just rewind your thinking just a little bit. We already found out that Jesus is coming, that it is a literal return, that he's going to come for the church. He's going to come for his bride. Now, the events that are going to take place, we do know that there is a great tribulation that's going to take place on the earth. Not just tribulation. Every believer in this world will have trouble or tribulation, trials that we go through. Currently, all over the earth, we do see tribulations taking place. We see the birth pains. We see signs. We see famine and earthquake. We hear of wars and rumors of wars, like Jesus said. The signs are all around us that we are living in the last days. One of the things that we also see is that out of that, there are scrolls, there are trumpets, and there are bowls of wrath. Pastor Deborah gave us an overview of this last time we were together. And it could be that it's not necessarily a timetable like we would understand in a linear fashion, because God is in eternity, and the apostle was getting a vision in the spirit. And even though the prophecy was delivered to him sequentially, you understand what I'm saying? It may not be chronological. In other words, when you read the book of Revelation and you see that it is a revelation of who and of what? Of Jesus Christ. It's not a revelation just of the end times. Yes, it shows us some things that must soon take place. However, the revelation is a revelation of Jesus Christ. Therefore, you will find in the book of Revelation, and we're going to take a look at some of these scriptures tonight, that there is a revelation of Jesus in eternity past. That there's a revelation of Jesus, the Lamb of God who was slain, Jesus on the cross, the redemptive work. You're going to see a revelation of the war that broke out in heaven before the earth was formed, between God and the devil, where original sin took place. One of the things that we find out is that also there must be a revelation here on the earth of the Antichrist. Now, who is the Antichrist? You know, like Pastor Luke jokingly said this morning, you know, every time we elect a new president into office, one side or the other calls that president the Antichrist, you know. Reading commentaries throughout the ages, many have pointed the finger at the Pope or the Catholic Church as the Antichrist. And there have been leaders, dictators, different political and different monarchies that have risen up throughout the ages, throughout the years, that people have said that's got to be the Antichrist. Look at what they're doing. So let's take a look at this together in the Word of God. 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. We're going to take a look at verse number 18. Look at what he says. 1 John chapter 2, verse number 18. He addresses us as little children. Look at what he says. Little children, it is the last hour. And as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, now notice that's capitalized. The Antichrist, speaking of a person. The Antichrist is coming. Even now, many Antichrists, lowercase a now, there are many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. So we can say assuredly that we know that we're living in the last days. How do we know that? Because many Antichrists have come. Now, we understand the word anti, meaning opposed to or against, correct? Now, in the original language, it also carries the connotation that it is in place of. Isn't that just like the devil? You remember the devil was the one who said in the book of Isaiah, I will exalt my throne above God's. I will be like God apart from God. I will ascend to the north. See, he said those five I wills because he wanted to be like God apart from God. He wanted the right thing the wrong way. See, we're called to be imitators of Christ, but we are never called to do it apart from Christ. It's a blessed union of God and man and God, God and us, and us in him. But the devil said, no, I don't want God. I don't want God's throne. I don't want God's authority or power. I want my own, and I want to be above God. And that's why he was cast out of heaven. And he sought to be in the place of God. He was anti. You understand what I'm saying? So when we find an antichrist, it's not only in opposition to, but it tries to take the place of. Very important for our understanding tonight. Satan, the devil, is our adversary. He is our accuser. Very important. He is a liar and a deceiver. Do we have that statement up on the overheads, guys? I know I gave them like a ton of stuff at the 11th hour. I gave it to them like a couple minutes before the church service. So anyways, they may not have that. There it is. Okay, if you're taking notes, you can write this down. Satan or the devil. There are two names that we find, okay? Satan or Diabolos, the devil, is our adversary and our accuser. Our adversary in the sense that he stands in opposition to us. And he is our accuser. You will find in the book of Job that the accuser had access to heaven at one time. And he would stand before God and he would accuse. God says, where you been? What are you doing? He says, I've been running throughout the earth, to and fro, inside and out. God says, have you considered my servant Job? Now God knew what he was doing. God knew where he was going with this. And what is the first thing the devil does? Does he bless you for nothing, God? He starts accusing. God, that's fake. He only does that because you bless him. See, Satan is the accuser. You find Satan standing next to the high priest in the vision, accusing and condemning Joshua the high priest until God gives him a new robe. The devil constantly is trying to accuse and to oppose the saints of God. Also, he is a liar. Jesus said he was the father of lies. It originated with him, and he is a deceiver. Just like in the Garden of Eden, you find the snake, the devil, that comes and he deceives Eve. Has God really said this? No. God didn't really say that. Will you surely die? Are you sure about that? Starts to put thoughts, things in, deceptions, lies. You will not surely die. God knows that in the day you eat of it, you shall be like him. And then the woman saw that it was good for food. See, she was deceived into thinking that she could attain the right thing the wrong way, just like the devil did. And it ushered in, her husband entered into willful rebellion and ushered in the fall. Now let's take a look at Satan. In the book of Revelation, you'll find out he is the dragon, okay? You're there in 1 John, turn a couple books over towards the back, towards the book of Revelation. If you hit the maps, you've gone too far, turn around, come back. Revelation chapter 12. In Revelation chapter number 12, we find a picture of the redemptive story. There is a woman who's pregnant, about ready to give birth, and a dragon comes and opposes her. War breaks out in heaven. Take a look at it. Let's start in verse 3. It says, another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great fiery red dragon, having seven heads and 10 horns and 7 diadems on his heads. Now, the imagery that we're given, remember, this is prophetic, and this is also given in the spirit. So the apostle is seeing spiritual things. So he sees a fiery red dragon, okay? In case you were wondering, dragons really do exist. Hello? And I like what G.K. Chesterton said about dragons. He said that the children's fables and stories are not there to tell us that dragons exist, but they're there to tell us that dragons can be defeated. Isn't that good? So here's a fiery red dragon having seven heads. Seven is the number of perfection. Heads were considered authority. So this devil, this dragon, has the perfect number of evil demonic authority. And it says in 10 horns, horns were strength. And 10 was the number of completion. He had complete strength. And then it says, and seven diadems on his heads, or crowns on his heads. Okay? Once again, speaking of his rule and his reign and his power. Verse number 4, his tail drew a third of the stars out of heaven and threw them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who's ready to give birth to devour her child as soon as it was born. See, if you remember in the account of the birth of Jesus, Herod, when he found out he was duped by the wise men, started to rage. And he started to murder babies. Everyone he could find in that region that was age 3 and under, according to the number of years when they saw the star appear. See, the devil tried to take out Christ as soon as he was born, and yet he was hidden where? In Egypt. Because Joseph was warned in a dream, took Mary and his son down to Egypt. Now, if we drop down to verse number 9, it says, so the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old. This defines us who it is. Who is this dragon? That serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Now, some scholars believe that that third of the stars representing the messengers or the angels of God, represented that a third of the angels of heaven were cast out with the devil and cast to the earth. That could be an interpretation of it. That also may not be. There's one verse about that. We do not see any other numerical amount given to the number of angels that fell with the devil. Okay? So we got to be careful when interpreting biblical things. But what we do know is that the devil does have angels that are now his demonic rule that now follow him and do his will. And we do know that the devil is loosed on the earth. And look at what it says, who deceives the whole world, he was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Verse 10, then I heard a loud voice and saying in heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of God and the power of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our brethren who accused them before our God day and night has been cast down. Now notice Jesus Christ, he came, he was born, and then he went to the cross, right? He was raised again from the dead, he ascended on high, and now Jesus spoke, he said, I saw Satan cast down like lightning. There was a war that took place in heaven, and the devil was cast out, and the devil was cast down to the earth. And it says in verse number 11, and they, speaking of the elect of God, speaking of us, okay, speaking of the brethren, of verse number 10, it says, and they overcame him, speaking of the devil, how? By the blood of the Lamb, and the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death. In other words, even though they may be martyred, even though their present circumstances may look like they were overtaken, really they overtook the devil in that. Are you listening tonight? You don't have to be afraid of the devil. You can overcome him how? By the blood of the Lamb, by the word of your testimony, not loving your life even unto death. Doesn't matter if somebody kills this body. Do not be afraid of him who kills the body. Be afraid of him who can kill the body and cast your soul into hell, Jesus said, right? We need to fear God and God alone. I don't fear the devil. Let's read on verse number 13. Now when the dragon saw that he had been cast down to the earth, he persecuted the woman who gave birth to the male child. Now some, again, scholars believe that this is just speaking of national Israel, but as well, others believe that this is speaking of the true church, which Jesus died for. And we do know that the devil now persecutes the church, believers. He does not like us. Why? Because we are the body of Christ. He wanted to exalt himself above the throne of God. And Jesus is God, in case you were wondering. Therefore, Satan would want to exalt himself above Jesus and be like God apart from God. So we see in the book of Revelation that this devil takes on imagery, or he takes on an imitation of God apart from God. So when you see what the devil does, remember, anti. He's coming not only in opposition to and against, but also trying to take the place of. So the devil knows that God is three persons, right? God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Now in the book of Revelation, we find that there is a satanic trinity that comes and exalts itself. So we see in the book of Revelation, chapter number 13, the beast. The beast. Again, much speculation about this. I would submit to your thinking that the beast is the Antichrist, the final consummation in a person, okay? And I'm going to show this to you tonight, okay? Revelation chapter 13, starting in verse number 1, we will read through verse number 10. I'm going to try and run through this, okay? I got a lot of stuff that we need to go through tonight. He says, "Then I stood on the sand of the sea." This is the apostle, John. "Stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his heads a blasphemous name." Now, stop right there. This beast looks just like the devil, doesn't he? Except for a couple of little differences. Notice he has 7 heads, and he has 10 horns, just like the red, fiery red dragon that we saw before. And it says, "And on his horns 10 crowns. Now, the devil had 7 diadems on his heads. He had 7 crowns on his heads. Now, this one has the crowns on the horns. Okay? A little bit different. We'll talk about that in a minute. "And on his heads a blasphemous name." Now, blasphemy is attributing the work of God to Satan. Okay? Calling good evil and evil good. All right? And opposition to that which is good. Okay? So, a blasphemous name would be one that is in opposition to and trying to take the place of God, which is evil but calling itself good. Verse 2. "Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority." Now why would the dragon do that? Because once again, remember, this is the satanic trinity, and they are working in unison with one another. And therefore, Satan is trying to be like God apart from God. He's trying to take that same place. He is not original. Satan is not original. He's a liar. He is a deceiver. That means in order for Satan to exist and in order for a lie to exist, the truth has to be first. There cannot be a lie without the truth. So that's why the devil comes being a copycat, is because he cannot have anything except that God gave it to him. Verse 3, "And I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the world marveled and followed the beast." Now notice there was a mortal wound. Just like Jesus died and went to the grave and was raised again, here there was a mortal wound. That means that this beast should have been dead from this wound, and yet he still lived. And the whole world was deceived by this, and they followed the beast. Verse 4, "So they worshiped the dragon who gave authority to the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, 'Who is like the beast? Who is able to make war with him?' And he was given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and was given authority to continue for 42 months, 3.5 years. Now, again, there's much speculation about this. Some people say that this is 3.5 years in the tribulation period, that the whole world accepts the beast, and then he crosses over and reveals his true nature, that he's eloquent, that he's wonderful, that he's deceptive up until this time. And then when he crosses over and sets himself as God in the place of God, that the world now realizes his true nature, and then they decide not to follow the beast, okay? That assumes that the church has already been raptured out before the beast comes. See, if I believed that, I wouldn't be teaching any of this tonight. I'd be teaching about how to be a Christian, because then you could be raptured out of here and you would not have to deal with the beast. Hello? And yet, many antichrists have already come. So that shows me that even if we don't deal with the antichrist, we're going to have to deal with many antichrists in our own lifetime. Hello? And it is very possible and very probable that the church will be here when the antichrist shows up on the earth. Now, you're going to have to study the Bible. You're going to have to read this through. You're going to have to study to show yourself approved like the Bible says, and you can make that decision. It does not affect your salvation, but it does affect your view of eternity. Now, I hope, oh God, I hope that the pre-tribulation guys are right, because that means we get out of here. We don't have to deal with the Antichrist. We don't have to deal with any of the persecutions, any of the seal, none of that. That would be wonderful. But guess what, church? What if the proverbial stuff hits the proverbial fan and we realize, oh my goodness, I'm here and there's the Antichrist and there's tribulation, and what am I going to do? We need to be ready. That's a good word for all of us. Let's continue reading. Verse number 5, he was given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. He was given authority to continue 42 months. Verse 6, then he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God. His blasphemy, his name, his tabernacle, and those who dwell in heaven. Verse 7, it was granted to him to make war with the saints and to overcome them, and authority was given him over every tribe, tongue, and nation. Now, quick thought about what we just said in these two verses. Now notice, everybody worshiped, but now he's given authority to make war with who? The saints, right? So obviously, everybody doesn't worship him, but everybody in the world. The saints won't worship the beast. But the beast is granted to make war with the saints and to overcome them. Now, wait a second. I thought we overcame him. We do. Temporary setbacks do not mean that the war has been won. This overcoming that the beast has will be a temporary thing. He may kill the body. He may martyr many. But his end is coming. We'll see it tonight, okay? We'll see it tonight. All right? Let's keep reading. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our brother who has accused them before our God day and night has been cast down. I'm sorry. I'm reading the wrong section here. I went back to 12. 13. 13. Let's try that one. Okay, verse 8. All who dwell on the earth will worship him whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. See, if you want to know whether or not you're going to be worshiping the beast, whether or not you're going to be persecuted by the beast, here's the deciding factor. Is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? That's what you have to know. If you know that you know that you know, I'm saved, I've given all of my heart, all of my life to Jesus, I've been born again, my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, then guess what? You don't have to worry about worshiping the beast. Okay? Secondly, you will be persecuted, but you don't have to worry about that either, because even if he kills your body, you get to be with Jesus. Absent from the body is present with the Lord, right? And there are martyrs under the throne of heaven who are given a special robe and special promises from the Lord. Very precious in the sight of God is the blood of his saints and the blood of the martyrs. Verse number 9, if anyone has an ear, let him hear. Verse 10, he who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. Look at this. Here is the patience and faith of the saints. That's what's going to overcome, is our faith. We need to be patient and wait on the Lord in times of trouble. Now, what do we see about this beast? Carries the same nature, carries the same authority of the dragon and of the devil. Now, we don't have time to go into this, so I'm going to quickly state, and you can read this on your own. There is another beast, verse number 11 of Revelation chapter 13. Verse number 11, another beast comes out of the land now. Okay. Now the sea could represent tumultuous times. It could represent the nations, the peoples that this beast rises up out of. Now out of the land comes another beast. Okay. It's a smaller, kinder, gentler looking beast. Why? Because it looks like a lamb and it only has two horns. Okay. Now those two horns, because it's coming out of the ground, could represent the natural and the spiritual, because we see this little lamb-like beast performing deceptive signs and wonders and miracles, even calling fire out of heaven to deceive the nations. He speaks on behalf of the beast. He causes the nations to worship the beast, as well sets up an image of the beast that he causes to speak. Very deceptive, because we would have said, well, idols and images can't speak, but now he animates this image of the beast and causes the nations to worship before it. Now, one quick little thought about this prophet or this second beast, okay, the false prophet that comes. It says he looks like a lamb, but he talks like a dragon. You want to know how you're going to know the false prophet? Listen to what he says. That's, see, sometimes we say, well, I got to study the devil. I got to know my adversary. I get it. Yes, I understand. We are not unaware of his devices. and we do know who our enemy is. We see him all throughout the Bible. And yet, I do not want to study the counterfeit as much as I want to know the reality and the substance and the one true and living God. I need to know the truth. I need to know the truth of Jesus Christ, not the lies of the enemy. I'm not going to study the book of Satan. I'm not going to study the Book of Mormon. I'm not going to study any other book. I'm going to study the Bible because this is the truth. Are you listening? When you know the truth, if something that looks like a lamb comes around, looks good, looks soft, looks kind, looks gentle, performing miraculous signs and wonders and miracles. See, that's why we don't follow signs, wonders, and miracles. We follow the truth of God's word. Because if it looks good, it's amazing and miraculous, we could be deceived. But if we listen and we hear the voice of a serpent, the voice of the dragon, then we won't follow that. Even though it looks nice, and even though it may be performing signs and wonders and miracles, we will not follow that false prophet, because listen to what he's saying. This sounds like the dragon. That sounds like the devil. There's deception there. See, the saints will not be overcome by the beast, except temporarily in physical things, as it is granted to him. Okay? Let's go back to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2 for a second. I want to show you a verse. We're going to launch out about the Antichrist, okay? And this is where I want to start talking about the person of the Antichrist. 1 John chapter 2, verse number 22 this time, says this. It says, "Who is a liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist who denies the Father and the Son." Okay? So this Antichrist that comes in opposition to, but also tries to take the place of, the Father and the Son is the Antichrist, okay? Now this starts as a spirit, okay? This starts as a spirit. Remember, many Antichrists have already come. This starts as a spirit, just as we saw that great dragon, the devil, starts as a spirit. Okay, you're there in 1 John 2. Turn with me to 1 John chapter 4, this time verse number 3. Look at what it says. 1 John chapter 4, verse number 3. "And every what? Spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of the Antichrist." Notice capital A now. This is the same spirit that's going to manifest in a person eventually, but it starts as a spirit. "This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world." See, the spirit is here. That spirit of Antichrist is already at work. Because once it starts as a spirit, it eventually becomes a system. Starts as a spirit, continues as a system. 1 John chapter 5. Now, verse number 19. 1 John chapter 5, verse number 19. "We know that we are of God, and the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one." See, it started as a spirit, the wicked one himself. And now his sway. Remember, it says that the powers of the principalities of this world, he's called the prince of the air, who's deceiving and blinding people's eyes. Starts as a spirit, but then it turns into a system. The devil is controlling the systems of this world, economies, politics, economics, governments, education systems. Starts as a spirit, continues as a system. Now, in the book of Daniel, chapter number 7, okay, you can turn there with me if you want to. We'll take a look at a couple of verses in Daniel chapter number 7. We see the same thing taking place. Daniel has been given visions. As Daniel is given these visions, he seeks to understand, and he prays. As he prays, he's given the interpretation. That interpretation helps us, when we take a look at the book of Revelation, to understand what is taking place, because the direct interpretation is given to Daniel, and now as we see that same imagery in the book of Revelation, we can apply it. The Bible interprets itself, okay? "Out of the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every matter be established." Scripture interprets Scripture. So as we understand some things in the book of Daniel, chapter number 7, about kingdoms, kings, and someone that is to come, a person that is to come. We understand about the devil, the Antichrist, and this beast that we see. Daniel has this vision of four different beasts. These four different beasts are battling, they're fighting a war. One of them looked like a lion, one of them looked like a bear, one of them looked like a leopard, okay? That sounds very familiar, doesn't it? You know why? Because we just read that the beast coming out of the waters in the book of Revelation looked like a lion, a bear, and a leopard. Then the fourth beast that Daniel sees says has teeth of iron. It's just a terrible image. And it has 10 horns. Once again, we see that same number 10. And then three of those horns are replaced by a little horn, and that little horn has eyes and a mouth and starts to speak great and blasphemous things. Once again, sounds very familiar, doesn't it? Now, we know from the interpretation that there was a direct interpretation given that these were kingdoms and kings that were taking place. Okay? And we understand that the lion was a picture of the Babylonian Empire. The bear was the Medo-Persian Empire or the Persian Empire, depending on how you interpret scripture. The leopard was a picture of the Persian or the Greek Empire. And the final beast may have been the Greek or the Roman Empire. Once again, depending on how you interpret scripture. I'm not here to make that decision for you, and neither do I land on any of that because I don't understand any of that. Hello, come on, somebody. It's okay to say I don't know sometimes, all right? Hopefully you know that when your pastor says that, that you can feel comfortable. And if somebody ever says to you, hey, what about the book of Revelation? What about all this end time stuff? You can say, I don't know, I'm learning. That's a perfectly acceptable answer. Or, hey, let's find out together, okay? Because we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but then when we get to heaven, we will see as we have been seen, and we will know as we have been known. God will straighten out all of our theology someday. Isn't that comforting that we don't have to have all the answers? Come on, somebody. That's good news. That's good news. Now, the horns are kings. We find out that the horns are kings, and the little horn speaking great things would have been a person, another king as well, that would come and that would utter these blasphemies, okay? Now, Daniel chapter 7, starting in verse number 23, he applies his heart to wisdom, and he starts to get the interpretation from an angel, and in Daniel chapter 7, verse number 23 through verse number 27, take a look at what it says, kind of towards the end of the chapter. It says, now the king was exceedingly glad for him and commanded, I'm in six. Thus he said, the fourth beast shall be a fourth kingdom on the earth, which shall be different from all other kingdoms and shall devour the whole earth, trample it and break it in pieces. The 10 horns are 10 kings who shall arise from this kingdom, and another shall rise after them. Look at that. Another shall rise after them. So there were kings and then another, that little horn, shall arise after them. This is another king. He shall be different from the first ones and shall subdue three kings. He shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall intend to change times and law. Then the saints shall be given into his hand for a time and times and half a time. Now, once again, that sounds very familiar, doesn't it? We read about that in the book of Revelation. See, history does repeat itself, and even though you may find instances of this in history, we find that the culmination of it will be not only a spirit, not only a system, but now a person of the Antichrist who is to come. He will raise up out of the social and economic turmoil of the earth. It will look like he was defeated and died. He will receive a mortal wound, and whether it's figurative or in reality, it's a lying sign that he comes back, and the whole world will be amazed by him. And we'll say, who's like him? And who's able to make war with him? He will be a political, social, economic, and military power. And therefore, when he comes, he will speak blasphemies. He will intend to change the times and the laws. And he will persecute the church. Are you listening? Verse 26, but. Oh, thank God for that three-letter word in the Bible. Don't you just love it? But the court shall be seated. Oh, come on, somebody. And they shall take away his dominion to consume and destroy it. How long? Forever. Then the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdoms under the whole heaven shall be given to the people, the saints of the Most High. See, it may look like you have a temporary setback. He may kill the body, but guess what? That rule, that reign, that authority, that dominion is coming back to the church who will rule and reign with Jesus Christ forever and ever. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him, capital H, speaking of the Most High, the Ancient of Days, our God. Wow. It culminates in a person. Let me wrap this thing up with this. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Turn there with me in the New Testament. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Remember, out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, I want to give you a third witness now, that this is a person that is to come in the earth. 2 Thessalonians chapter number 2, starting in verse number 1. Okay, again, I'm going to run through some verses here, okay? You have the Holy Spirit. You can read through these verses again, and the Holy Spirit will teach you about these things. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1. Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, we're talking about the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him. We ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. See, they had thought they missed it. They thought Jesus came and they missed it, right? He says, but don't worry about that. Verse 3, let no one deceive you by any means. For that day, capital D, speaking of the day of the Lord when Jesus comes, the judgment day, it will not come unless, okay, so there's some things that have to happen first. The falling away comes first. Now, you cannot fall away from something that you have not attained to. So there will be shocking falling away of people who call themselves Christians from the church. There will be great deception. Jesus said the love of many will grow cold. The falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition. Now, that man of sin, in other translations, says the man of lawlessness. Remember, he will try and change the law. He will be given authority and dominion. He has crowns on those 10 horns. The son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember the lying signs and wonders we talked about? Now, again, there are different interpretations of this, that there will be a real rebuilding of the temple in Jerusalem, that this son of perdition will sit there and erect an image of himself, much like the Roman emperors did, and they caused people to bow down and worship before it and pledge their allegiance to it. But remember that there is also another temple on the earth that God now dwells in, that's in our hearts. And there is a falling away, and that beast, if he is worshipped, will set himself up as God in the hearts of man. We have to watch ourselves, church. We have to beware lest we fall, like the Apostle Paul said. We have to fear lest we ourselves also fall into temptation. We have to save others, snatching them as out of the fire. We have to make sure that we keep our noses clean. We have to make sure that we're walking in the power and the authority and the grace of God, that we're keeping our vision on him so that we are not a part of those who fall away. Let no one deceive you. Verse 5, do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? Verse 6, and now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness, there it is once again, lawlessness is already at work, is already at work. Many antichrists have already come, is already at work. Only he, capital H, who now restrains, will do so until he is taken out of the way. So we know that God is the one who is restraining, and is the hand of God that must be taken out of the way for this lawless one to be revealed and set himself up as God and show himself as God. Verse number 8, and then the lawless one will be revealed, of whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. Take courage, saints, because this beast, as he shows up and as he's revealed, he doesn't have a long time to do all this stuff. Every time you read about him, as soon as you read about him, the Lord's destroying him. That's good news. That is very good news. Verse number 9, the coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish, because, look at this, because, why? Because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. God has given them a chance God has given them the gospel they have known, and yet they rejected it. Now, because they rejected it, look at the next verse. For this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they should believe the lie. God is not unjust in doing that. They've already rejected him. So he sends them a strong delusion that they may believe the lie. Now look at verse 12. That they all may be condemned who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Wow. Wow. Now we're going to continue in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. So let's put a pause button right there for a second. Okay? These people that we see here took pleasure in the truth. They worshiped the beast. And he set himself up as God, at the very least, in their hearts. Now, we have to deal, if we're dealing with the Antichrist, we have to deal with the mark of the beast. Okay, let's talk about this. Much speculation. A lot of different stuff has been said about the mark of the beast. Now, just like the redeemed, remember, the devil has no original stuff, okay? And as the redeemed, we are marked for the day of redemption. We are sealed by the Holy Spirit. God has put his mark on us. So in the same way, the devil sees that, and now he marks those that are his. Now, those who take his mark share his fate. Let me say that again. Those who take his mark, the mark of the beast, share his fate. Revelation chapter 14, hold your finger in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. We'll come back there because there's some good stuff that I want to end with, okay? I want to end on a high note because this can be heavy, can't it? I mean, talking about people dying is never, never fun, never good. God is not pleased with the death of the unrighteous. He grieves, he mourns, he cries. Revelation chapter 14, verse number 11. Those who take his mark share his fate. Let's look at it. And the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night, who worship the beast and his image, and whoever receives the mark of his name. Those who take his mark share his fate. The devil is destined for hell. And those who receive the mark of the devil are destined for the same fate. This is not popular. People don't like you when you tell them this. But it's not out of a mean spirit that we tell people this. It's because we know the terror of the Lord. And it's because we love people and God loves people enough that they don't have to have this fate. They have this time. They have this chance. They have the gospel being preached to them. They can be saved and they can repent. Now, how do I know if I've taken the mark? Should I be afraid of a barcode? Should I be afraid of a tattoo that they put on my hand or on my forehead? Should I be afraid of a microchip? I mean, if that was the case, I would not have received the new credit card that my bank sent me in the mail because it had a little microchip on it. We're getting closer and closer to the mark of the beast. Look at it, it's in my credit card now. You can't buy or sell without it. But can I tell you something? I don't believe that it is something so physical and natural like that. I believe it's much deeper. Okay, if that was the case, cough syrup, you guys remember this? Can we put a picture of it up on the overheads? You guys got that? I don't know if they got the picture of the cough syrup. Maximum strength, 666 allergy and cold relief. Way back in the day, there was 666 cough syrup, and eventually it formed tablets so that when the beast has a headache and sinus pressure, that's him right there, you see the red. What about this one? I heard about this, you know, Lexmark computing systems and telephone systems and all that kind of stuff. Pastor Joel, do you remember this? A while back, they had a certain telephone and their emblem was a ring of fire. And everybody was all up in arms because look at the building in New York, 666 Fifth Avenue in New York. You guys got that picture? This was the building of the beast, right? Because this company that was telecommunications worldwide had the ring of fire. They're at 666 New York. That's got to be the mark of the beast that everybody's, you know, global communications, knowledge shall increase, all that kind of stuff. Can I tell you something? Foolishness, you guys. It's not about that. If that was the case, then where I used to live in Redlands, over by Albertsons, there's a little street, and it's got a little house on it called 666 Palm Avenue. That must be the devil's house where he lives. He drives a Buick, and he has a boat. The problem is, that's east Palm Avenue. If you go to West Palm Avenue, there's another 666 Palm Avenue where the devil must have a second home across town in Redlands. I don't know what he's doing there, but apparently he likes old Victorian style houses. Taking the mark is much more than a physical thing. It involves worshiping the beast. Revelation 13, 15 through 18, I'll put it up on the overheads for time's sake. He was granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. That would not worship the image of the beast. See, as Christians, we know the truth. And therefore, because we know the truth, we will detect the lie. We'll hear the voice of that little lamb that talks like a devil, that talks like a dragon, and we'll say, no, I'm not buying into that. And when he causes that image to animate and to start speaking, and he starts to say, worship me and worship the image that I've created, and the whole world is bowing down in submission to this idol, and we say, no, I'm not going to bow down, and our lives are taken from us because of it. Verse 16, he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads, and that no one may buy or sell except one who has the mark of the name of the beast or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of man. His number is 666. Now, once again, his number is the number of a man, okay? So we understand that the beast is an incarnate person, okay? It started with a spirit, turned into a system, and now it's incarnate of a man, number one. So that's telling us something, that this is a man that's coming forth, okay? Second, what it's telling us, 666, okay? Now, there's been a lot of speculation about this number. Remember that Greek and Hebrew did not have numerical systems as we do, so these were letters, okay? So oftentimes we look at 666 or 666 and we think all sorts of stuff, and we calculate the name of Nero and we calculate the name of Jesus and we calculate all this stuff. But listen, guys, I would suggest to you it's not really about that. It's the number of a man. This beast answers every problem of a man. Who is like the beast and who can make war with the beast? Remember, they loved him. His number is the number of a man. Therefore, if it's man and it's not God, see, God is the one who should be giving us direction. God is the one whom we should worship and bow down and serve and submit to. God is the one who we should be receiving our directions from. And therefore, if we receive the directions that just tickle our ears or that feel good or look good, but yet it sounds like a dragon, we're settling for less. Remember, the number of seven is the number of perfection. It's God's number. And so six would be less that, and it's a trinity of sixes, trinity of imperfection. It's good, but it won't make it. It's the number of man, not the number of God. And therefore, we're not going to receive that mark. Why? Because we're not going to worship the beast. Now, second thing is this. What do you do with your hands? Come on, shout it out at me. What do you do with your hands? I'm sorry, what? You work, right? You do stuff. What do you do with your head? You think. So it will be evident if you've taken the mark of the beast by, first of all, whom you worship, what you think, and what you do. Your will and your works will determine who you worship. Let me say that again. Your will and your works will determine who you worship. That shows the mark of the beast on your life. Plain and simple. I don't care. You want to implant a chip? Whatever. It's not a big deal to me, because I will show you by my will and by my works whom I serve. I'm not afraid of any of that kind of stuff. All right? I will not bow down and worship the beast. You won't accidentally take it, because it will be a life or death matter. Are you listening? You can't accidentally take the mark of the beast. It won't be that the United States of America is imprinting chips in everybody and you're, oh, well, I must have accidentally took it. I guess now I'm going to hell. No. By your will and your works, you will determine who you worship, and that will determine your destiny. Okay? 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. You guys still there? I'm coming in for a landing. Somebody say hallelujah. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse number 13. Let's read the good news about this whole thing. Remember, he just got done telling about the Antichrist who's coming. Just got done telling all the lawless deeds. God's sending them strong delusion so that they should not believe the truth, but be given over to the lie. And there's punishment that comes with that. They had pleasure in unrighteousness. Verse 13, look at this. But we are bound to give thanks to God always for you. Church, I am so happy and so thankful for you. Why? Brethren, beloved by the Lord, because God, from the beginning, chose you for salvation through sanctification, setting yourself apart as a holy instrument of God. You don't have pleasure in unrighteousness. You're set aside for God's holy purposes. By the Spirit, remember, we are sealed by the Spirit of God. We've taken the mark of God on us, and belief in the truth. We don't believe the lie. We believe the truth. Verse 14, to which he called you by our gospel for the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. See, we don't share in the devil's fate. We share in our brother Jesus's fate. Wow. Verse 15, therefore, brethren, stand fast. Everybody say, stand fast. And hold the traditions which you were taught, whether by word or our epistle, our letter. Verse 16, now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and our God and Father, who has loved us and given us everlasting consolation and good hope by grace. See, we don't have fearful expectation of the end times. We have everlasting consolation. Doesn't matter what you do here on the earth. I am going to be with Jesus forever and ever and ever and ever. And I know that he's given me his grace, his sovereign, divine ability to get the job done on my behalf when I can't do it. Why? So that I can endure tests and trials and even martyrdom if I have to. That's the grace of God that was given. That's the good hope we have. We have the hope of Christ in us, the hope of salvation, the hope of eternity. I don't look to the future with fear. I look to the future with faith, knowing that I'm going to be with Jesus. Verse 17, comfort your hearts and establish you in every good word and work. Oh, wait a second. Wait a second. Every good what and what? Every good word. And work. We just talked about your will and your works, didn't we? Your words come out of the abundance of your heart, right? Yes. See, we will show whom we serve. Couple of quick thoughts. First one is this. The devil is a liar and a defeated foe. We know his end. That's number one. The devil, everybody say this. The devil is a liar and he's a defeated foe. I know his end. Let me show it to you. Revelation chapter 20, verse 10. The devil who would deceive them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone where the beast and the false prophet are. And they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. The devil is a defeated foe. If he comes trying to remind you of your past, you remind him of his future. Second thing is this, have confidence in conflict. Have confidence. Church, stand up. Church, be bold. Church, be brave. We know we win. We have read the back of the book. The devil is defeated. He's a liar. You have the victory. You can do it. You can endure it. You have it already. Jesus is yours. Even if the circumstances temporarily set you back, you come out on top in the end. Last thought is this, declare whom you worship by your thoughts and your actions. We need to declare that each and every day whom we serve with our thoughts and our actions. What are you dwelling on? What are you thinking on? What are you saying? What's coming out of you? And what are you doing with your hands? If it's not the right thing, it's time to repent. That means change the course that you are on and go God's direction. Tonight, I want to just, before anybody gets up, before anybody leaves, some of you in this place, you've heard this preaching and this teaching, you heard this message, and you're saying, my goodness, you know, I hear what you're saying. I hear what you're talking about eternity. Pastor, I don't know if I were to die right now or if Jesus were to come, whether or not I would make it. Maybe you know that you've been serving the wrong God. You've been serving the lowercase God of this world, Satan, with your will and your works. I'm going to ask nobody get up during this time. Come on. Nobody disturb the attention of anybody else around in this place. Why don't you just focus in for A couple minutes. Give me a couple minutes of your time. How do you know where you're going to go? Where will you end up? Whether heaven or hell? Because as we read, hell's a very real place. And I don't want you to go there. You don't want you to go there. But listen, most of all, God doesn't want you to go there. That's why he sent Jesus, beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross, was so that you didn't have to go. Now, do you get there just because you're a good person? Do good works, clean up your act? Well, no, because if that was the case, then the guys that were good in Jesus' day, Jesus would have commended. He would have told them, you're doing a good job. And yet he didn't. He actually told them that they're whitewashed sepulchers. See, on the outside, they looked good. They were clean. But on the inside, it was all dead. Our good works won't make it. In fact, the Bible tells us that our goodness compared to God's goodness is like filthy rags. It's going to get thrown out. And if you're trying to get to heaven just based on your good works, you're not going to make it, because the standard is perfection. And the only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. Not going to make it based on your good works. Not going to make it based on church attendance. Sometimes people think, well, if I am raised in church or I attend church on a regular basis, I'll get to go to heaven. And yet that's like me saying, if I just want to be a fish, I could go to the ocean, sit in the water, call myself a fish, and that makes me a fish. Doesn't matter how long I stay there. Doesn't matter if I was raised in the ocean. My parents told me I was a fish growing up. Doesn't matter any of that stuff. I'm just a slimy human being after a little while. You know what I'm saying? You don't get to heaven because you sit in a church service or you're raised in church, you call yourself a Christian. Doesn't make you a Christian. You don't get to heaven because you're not some other religion or because you were born in America. Come on. Somebody please tell us the truth. Tonight, you've seen the scriptures. You know the truth. You're not going to make it based on your good works. You're not going to make it based on your church attendance. Not going to make it based on volunteering in church or any of that kind of stuff. Now we're back to good works. Has to be something else. Sometimes people say, well, I just know God and I know about, Christmas and you talked about the birth of Jesus. I sing the songs every year of my life. I celebrate the resurrection at Easter time every year. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian because I know God? I could quote scriptures. You know that Revelation one? I could have quoted that to you, Pastor. That's great. I'm glad you can do those things. Show that to me in the Bible where you can quote scripture, celebrate a holiday, or you know who God is in your head. You know what the Bible says? The Bible says the devil knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures. And yet he's not a Christian headed for heaven. We saw his end. What makes the difference between heaven and hell? Jesus said it like this. He said, you must be born again. Now I know sometimes people turn off at this point. They say, oh, born again? I heard about that too. That's weird. I don't want to have anything to do with that. I saw that on a movie. I watched a weird, goofy guy, that said he was born again on television. I read about it in books and on blogs on the internet. I don't want to be born again. Well, listen, you will not make it to heaven unless you are born again. What does being born again really mean? Well, it's always meant the same thing. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Book of Revelation, once again, chapter 3, Jesus is speaking to a church. Can you imagine this? Speaking to people in church. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Now that just proves to me that people who sit in church and call themselves Christians, that alone does not make them a Christian. It's got to be something more. What's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again. An occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, by your will and your works, you're declaring that you worship another God. God says it's all or nothing. There's no halfway. Half-hearted results will not get you all the way there. It's got to be a wholehearted commitment, giving God all of your heart and all of your life. Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today, I want to give you this opportunity to do just what we're talking about. Be born again in this place tonight. You don't have to go to hell. You don't have to share the fate of the devil and the beast and that false prophet. You don't have to go where the Antichrist is. You can be with Jesus forever and ever by surrendering all of your heart and all of your life to him. Tonight, I'm going to give you that opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three, just like this. One, two, three. And when I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together, just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're acknowledging your need for Jesus, saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You could put it right back down. You say, well, wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's get over that embarrassment. Because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment in a safe and friendly church service like this than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one would make that trade. Moment of possible embarrassment for an eternity away from God? Come on. That's not you. Yeah, the devil's trying to talk you out of it right now. Oh, it's just emotionalism. He's just hyped you up. You don't really have to do it. You're okay. No, listen, tell that devil of his future. He can go jump in a fiery lake forever. You're not going there with him. You're going on with God tonight. Jesus said, you confess me before men. I'm a man. I'll see your hand go up. He says, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But he also said, if you deny me, I will deny you. Your call, your choice. Will you give him all of your heart and all of your life tonight? Or you sit there and do nothing when you know you need to get right with God? Your call, your choice. I've done my job. I've loved you enough to tell you the truth. God's done his job, sending Jesus, beaten, bloody, and hung on the cross. Now it's your turn. Will you give him all of your heart and all of your life? All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching my television, the foyer, the Love Rock Cafe, or online, come on, get ready to get your hand up. Who should raise their hand? You've been running from God instead of to God. I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Tonight is your night. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this before? Never said yes to Jesus. I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm? You know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. If that's you, need to give God all of your heart, need to give God all of your life. There's one, two, three. Thank you. God bless you. There's four. Got you over there. Four wise people. There's five up top over there. I got you. Five, six. Got you right there. Thank you. Six wise people already. Who else? Know you need to give God all of your heart and know you need to give God all of your life. I didn't embarrass them. And I won't embarrass you. Anybody in the family rooms? I can see you guys back there. Anybody on this side? Anybody? Wave it at me if that's you. Anybody that I did not already see down here? Come on, just lift it up high for me. And I'm looking in your direction. Anybody else? Come on, let's go for God tonight. There's already six wise people already. You won't be embarrassed and you won't be alone. Anybody else? Thank you, seven. God bless you. Who else tonight? You say, I want to just make sure. I want to secure my place in heaven. Come on, anybody else? I'm giving you the opportunity right now to believe the truth and to reject the lie. Who else tonight? There's seven wise people already. Come on, anybody else? Go ahead. Just lift it up right now if that's you. Anybody else? Let's go for God tonight. All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for seven wise people. Hallelujah. All seven of you, if you're in the foyer or on campus, you can hear the sound of my voice. I want you to listen up. If you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, come on. It's not too late. Here's what I want you to do. In a moment, we're all going to stand, give a clap and a shout. As we do, once you get out of your seat, get in the aisle and meet me up front. We're going to change destinies tonight. Can't do that till we get you down here. So if that's you, you raise your hand or you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Let's all stand and welcome them. Come on down. Come on down. Let's give them a hand as they come. Hallelujah. Come on. Come on. They're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come. From the family rooms, if you want to bring your children, you can come right now. Come on down, come on down, come quickly. Anybody else, if you need to come, you just come right now, make your way to the front. Let your neighbor say, come on, friend, I'll go with you. Best decision of your life, come on down right now, if that's you. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Anybody else, if you need to come, come on down right now. Hallelujah. If anybody else is coming or you haven't yet started that walk, you can come right now while I'm giving some instructions. Hey, guys, up front, put a big smile on your face. This is a really good thing, not a bad thing, okay? Came to give God all your heart. Came to give God all of your life. That's awesome. Now, listen, I love you. I'm so excited. We're going to be together forever in heaven with Jesus. That's the best. That is just the best, all right? Now, God doesn't come in because you raised your hand. He comes in when you invite him. He's a gentleman, okay? Right over here to my right, your left. See this guy waving at you? This is Pastor Joel. He's a really good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? This dude is about the weirdest one you're going to encounter tonight, okay? He's cool. He's going to do three things. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some free literature, find out what to do next in your walk with God. Now that you're a Christian, what do you do? All right? He'll give that to you. It's absolutely free. It's really easy reading. Take about a half hour if you sit down and read it slow. Third thing he's going to do, he's going to give you the mark of the... No, he's not going to do any of that, okay? Just kidding. All right. He's going to... Come on. We need to relax. It's okay, all right? He's going to give you a spiritual personal trainer, okay? We call them SPTs. They're friends, all right? We give away friends here at The Rock. They're neat people, and they'll be your best friends here at church. Help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord. He'll describe how that works, and I'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you, okay? Make a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right this way. Love you, Pastor Joel. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to The Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.